I think your rent's a little different than that.
But I think, I know they are, so you can see each other, but you can't hear each other.
Hey, yeah, so there we go.
Melissa, she's on the same.
Oh, my gosh.
Clark, C-L-A-R-K, actually, I can give you.
Who are these people?
It's.
Good afternoon. How nice it is to see you for this afternoon. How an honor, Diane, to be able to introduce to you a highly respected, very brave soldier of the Union Army who valiantly fought at Harrisburg, and in many other battles. They helped us win the war and free the slaves. Of course, the cost was high, very high. The sacrifices were great, and the scars on our nation were very deep. But Seth Hill and his brothers, George, Charles, John, and Erastus, left their home and their mother here in Greenfield, enlisted, and survived 4 years of mortal danger. The story of their battle experiences, their great concern for their mother all alone in our little town, and their constant prayer to be able to come back home and go on with their quiet farm life they had known since they were children is told in 67 letters which Seth wrote to his mother. Seth was the most prolific of the five, and in his correspondence he constantly talked about his mother. But when we asked him to read to you some of his letters, he laughed uproariously and shouted, "You want I should read some of that stuff to strangers?" He laughed so strenuously that he fell forward with the force of his guffaws. His rumpled old black felt hat dropped off his head onto the newly sprouted corn growing in the field around us as we were talking. His large, work-hardened hand reached down quickly and swiped his hat up off the fertile soil. He spun around so quickly, it almost seemed as if he were on a timetable, or a turntable. But that wasn't the case. He dashed out of the field and disappeared behind the battered, old brown barn. Several days later, I ran into him down at the general store. Almost bashfully, he came up to me and said, Say, ma'am, I meant no harm at all the other day. If you want to use them there letters, maybe you can get my brother George to do it. He reads better. He's up in the woods cutting right now, because he's going to make some furniture for our mother. Well, we went up into those woods, got our feet soaking wet, and talked George into reading his brother's letters. And I'm very proud and very honored to be able to introduce to you a former Civil War soldier, brave defender of liberty, and proud family man. Here he is, right here, George Hill.
Thank you for that kind but a bit exaggerated introduction. How happy I am to have this chance to let people hear my brother's letters. He writes real good. He tells it just the way it is, and he makes people see in their heads what he writes about. I'm just the other way. I can shoot the breeze if somebody else puts it on paper. We make a good team, don't we? So here goes. This first letter of Seth's, which he wrote in Alexandria, Virginia, on March 26, 1984. Dear Mother, it is with pleasure that I now take my pencil in hand to write you a few lines to let you know that I am well, and I hope this will find you the same. We got here yesterday after a hard march. We was on the road 10 days from Franklin, which is about 180 miles. We found lots of spurger on the way. We have seen thousands of hogsheads, as nice as you ever see. We made the hens and hogs suffer, I tell you. We expected to have a brush with the Rebs before we got here, but they all skedaddled. We expect to go to Shreveport. We shall have some fighting, but we have got force enough to lick them out. I expect a letter from you today. I hope I shall get one so I can hear from that money. If you have not wrote about it, write in your next. We expect the Rebs is about 25,000 strong. We have about 190 miles before we get to Shreveport. Well, I have made such work in writing. Guess I had better stop. The most I care about is to let you know that I am well. Give my love to all. I can't think of no more at present to write. Only write soon. This is from your affectionate son, Seth, to his dear mother. That takes a lot of courage, doesn't it, to carry on like that? Of course, I was in it too, but Seth got more hand-to-hand up close than I did. Oh, I ain't quite sure what he was a-telling about when he told about the hogsheads. You know, a hogshead is a big barrel, but I ain't focusing on his meaning there. Hey, Seth was always real worried about our mother. You heard it in his letter, didn't you? Sure, I did worry too, but I guess I thought she was more better able to take a hold than Seth did. Well, let's go on and hear this next letter. This here letter, you'll get a swift kick out of. Seth was a funny one, all right. He wrote two letters, one a crazy one and one a regular one. He was at Camp Sheridan in Virginia when he wrote these here ones. Maybe it was the hot, sticky weather down there that got to his befuddled brain. I ain't got a clue. But when our cousin Ann saw it, she said, he right in the head. But I know that ain't so. Seth, of all of us hills, was tops when it comes to being right in the head, I'll tell you. He was just having a bit of fun. See what you think. Dear Mother, I take my pen in hand to write you a few lines to let you know that I am well and to let you know that I am not crazy. The letter you speak of was not intended for a letter. I wrote a letter at the same time that I put that in the office after I got the letter wrote. I thought that I would write a little in the draft, and I also wrote some verses that I think would be appropriate to some of our young ladies up in Greenfield. So you see that I am not out of my head. Write to let me know if you've got the letter or not. I put the $10 in that funny letter, as Ann called it. I intended to put the money in the other letter, but I guess it was a good mistake if you did not get the letter. We left camp at 8 a.m. in the morning and marched 20 miles to a place called Snickers Gate. We hadn't been there long before we saw 17 Rebs, but they was across the Shenandoah River. We exchanged a few shots, but without any effect. They were too far away and we could not cross the river. We stayed there all night. When we got back to camp, I found a letter from you and Ann. Well, dear Mother, I am some tired tonight, so I will close by saying that I got those stamps. Goodbye, write real soon. This is from your loving son, Seth, to his dear mother. Write soon, yours truly. So what do you think? Sounds good to me. Of course, it's my brother after all. Hey, look. This next one he wrote in Savannah, Georgia in December 1865. Does that 1865 ring a bell with you? Sure, sure, sure. The year the war slowed and slowed and came to a screeching halt. Thank God, when I read this one, pay special attention. Really perk up your mind when you hear this here first sentence, because it sort of sums up what Seth tried to do every minute he could during the fighting, before the fighting, and sure, especially after the fighting. He just always wanted to be sure our mother always knew he was still all in the land of the living. Yeah, I didn't want her to worry, not at all, but I just guess I was a bit more careless in a telling her all the time that Seth was, say, as you hear this next letter, Seth's tale. Listen to what they all had to eat. Dear Mother, I take my pen in hand to let you know that I am safe on land again and in the state of Georgia. The weather is warm. I have been out and got what blackberries I wanted to eat. They have everything here in abundance. Green apples, cabbage, and everything in the garden line. Well, now I will tell you how I like it first rate, but it's damnable hot. That's what ails the house. But Savannah is the prettiest city that I've ever seen, and I have seen quite a good many. I reckon I don't see anything about the place I know. It is very much different than I expected. I don't think we will stay here long. I hope not. 2 weeks will be long enough, then go somewhere else. I wanted to see the country for the next 4 months, but when I get home, I suppose I will have to stay there. I am going down this morning to take a view of the whole concern. Well, dear mother, I don't suppose that you thought I would go as far from home when the war is over, but such is the fate of many. I have got it in my mind that we will go to make it. I hope so, after we stay here long enough for me to take a good survey of the country. That is the most I intend to do, to see the country. Well, now the mail is about to go out. I will have to hurry up my case. Give my love to all. Excuse this poor writing, for I am tired and in a hurry. Tell Sadie I received her letter in Washington, but have no time to answer it. I will as soon as I can. John will be out of the service before long. From your absent son, Seth Hill, to his mother. How'd you like what he told about Savannah? Did you notice he said he ain't got time to answer Sadie's letter, which he got in Washington? But you know, he always had time, even he was tired and in a hurry, as he said in his writing, to write to our mother. Say, I got one more right here under my elbow. Let's see what old Seth had to say from Franklin, Louisiana, on March 11, 1864. Dear mother, I now take my pen in hand to write you a few lines to let you know that I am well and hope when these few lines reaches you, it will find you the same. But it will be some days before it reaches you, mother. I am some ways from home, but I like it here very well. It is 1,840 miles from New York City to New Orleans, and it is 125 miles from New Orleans to Franklin. We have had a heavy thunder shower since we came here. I don't suppose the bullfrogs bothers you any up in Old Greenfield yet. The frogs and crickets and birds make music for us. It is like July in Greenfield. Since I have been writing, there has been 2 regiments of colored men passed. I suppose they will join our expedition. I think we will start within a few days. I hear there will be 75,000 men start from this place. Give my love to Jane and tell her to write to me. Love to all and save a share for yourself. I want you to write if you've got that money I sent before I left Washington, D.C. I sent $35 and wrote a letter. This is from your affectionate son, Seth Hill, to his beloved mother. $35 had to be a lot of money back in Civil War times. Just hear those crickets and birds and bullfrogs, Seth mentioned, but it's just a bit more testy to picture the 75,000 men who will be a starting out from Franklin, isn't it? Wasn't it nice he told our mother to give his love to all, to save a share for herself? That's Seth, all right. What's that I hear? I hear something, do you? It's music, nice relaxing music. It's the same music we hear all the while when we had a calm day and our boys can break out the instruments. That is, if the Rebs didn't try to swipe us out. Say, that's nice. Uh-huh. Why, if it just almost goes off right here, right in this little old chair. Well, well, my bones are all stretched out. The kinks are all gone and I'm all relaxed. How about you? Say, you're a mighty good-looking crowd, all calm, your tension's all gone. Say, I'd like to check out my brother's letters for a little bit more. How about you? Bully, bully. That's what what I always say when I get real excited. And now we're all calm and easygoing. How about taking a look at Seth's letter, which he wrote from Winchester, Virginia, on November 7, 1864. Dear Mother, I now seat myself down in the kitchen to answer your most welcome letter, which I received today. Oh, by the way, you know Seth didn't have a kitchen. He was writing from his tent. But you know Seth by now, he loved to be funny. Even as a little kid, I remember how he was always playing tricks on the rest of us and laughing his head off. Anyway, he goes on to say, your letter found me well in building a fireplace so my old woman and my boy can take comfort. I have a pretty good house. How long we shall stay to have the good of it, I don't know. If we stay 3 days, we'll do well. Well, dear Mother, I'm very sorry to hear that you are sick, but I am contented as long as Jane stays with you, for I know she will take grand care of you. Well, I suppose you will be seeking for old Seth to be home this winter, but you need it. I thought I would be home, but I failed, and I may as well accept this. But I think I will get home in the course of 11 months, but I think it may be 11 months more than I expected. We are resigned to Sheridan's command. What do you think of Sheridan around Quarter Corners? Well, as Abe is elected again, I am glad of it. Send those gloves by mail as soon as you can, and a few stamps. Goodbye, your devoted son, Seth Hill. Bye-bye. Yes, yes. I was real glad Jane was taking care of Mother. She got well and was soon out weeding the garden after a short spell of sickness. Thank God. This next letter of his is pretty serious because he was so very worried about Mother being home all alone and all of us boys, me, him, John, Charles, and Erastus, all fighting the rebels. He's worried we'd all be swiped out and then Mother will be all alone. Oh, sure, sure, there are neighbors and friends, but that ain't the same as having five sons to see your care, is it? Anyway, here's what he said. As I read it, it just doesn't sound like Seth, because he's usually always funny and upbeat, but I know he was really, really worried about Mother. Well, I must write a little bit about something that is important, and that is about what you wrote before. You say that the people says that you can get me out of the service. I think so, too, for I hear if five of us is in the service, that is too many, and you need some good man to look after you and work for you. I think you should write James G. Marmon. He was a member of Congress. Tell him you can do it for $50. It will be no object if you can get me out of this scrap. Don't wait to write him and let me know what the prospect is of me getting out of the service. Give my love to all and tell them I'm around like a duck on a June bug. Well, well, even though it was a pretty serious letter, old Seth couldn't resist one funny line, could he? Say this next letter from Stevens Depot, Virginia, on February 19, 1864, is a real good one because it has right good news for our mother. Listen. Dear Mother, I now take pen in hand to let you know I'm well and hope this finds you the same. I sometimes write a bit too much about these darn Rebs, which ain't good news, but now as I'm writing, it's going to be real good news. I'm writing to tell you I've been promoted to orderly sergeant, and now I man those diamonds that is in one of those books that I left at home. Give my regards to everyone and tell them there were 6 inches of snow here and we got 6 inches more, but the weather is mild here in comparison to Greenfield. The boys all thought I'd get my discharge, but it ain't happened. Well, everything is quiet here. I don't know of any more news, so I'll close bidding you goodbye and hoping to hear from you real soon. This is from your absent son, Seth Hill, to his beloved mother. Wasn't that a real nice letter? A real lifter-upper, if I do say so myself. Seth was sure enough deserved a promotion. He was a real loyal son of a gun, much more than me. And now, to bring this letter reading to a close, I chose one with the very most important date in the whole lifetime of me and my four brothers and my mother, too, April 15, 1865. What a day, what a day. Seth was at Summit Point, Virginia, and here is what he said. Dear Mother, I now take pen in hand to answer your most welcome letter, which I received last evening, and right glad was Seth to hear from you. We have been on the go ever since I wrote to you before. We have moved every day and got our tents fixed up in good shape. We have been up above Winchester and all around the Sap Woods on Sunday night at 11 o'clock. We got the news of Lee's surrender, and it rained like the devil. But the boys got up, and the air rang with music. They was a happy bunch of men. I assure you, we'll be hearing the first thing we know that peace is declared. But I don't expect to get home until my time is out, and I don't care much. I don't want to go home in the middle of summer. If I could be home now, I'd like it first rate. Every day we're well, Mother. I guess when I get married, I will be apt to know something about it myself. I expected to die an old bachelor, as all the young ladies has got the idea that soldiers are of no account. But I think when the soldiers get home, they will hold their arms up, if I'm not very much mistaken. I think I am quite as good a man as some of my citizens that is hunkered up at home and had their soft bread and their feather beds to sleep on. But I don't ask any particular odds of them. At any rate, well, I have said enough on that subject. As I am sleepy and tired, I'll close bidding you a good night. This is from your devoted son, Seth Hill, to his dear mother. Well, well, that was quite a letter, wasn't it? Seth was always a deep thinker. All of us boys always went to him. Our father died early, so Seth was the one we counted on to come up with his good stuff. Even our mother, too. She was always a saying. Say, who's this a coming in here? I can't believe what my eyes aren't telling me. Talk about the past, and it walks right in when you least expect it. Dr. Walker, what are you doing here? How'd you get here? I ain't seen you since...
Yeah, you haven't seen me since you were so sick in the hospital. Remember, with chronic bronchitis? We really got to know one another then, didn't we?
Oh my God, yes. Oh, that was awful. I was a-catching for breath, and you put the pillows under my head so I could get a smidgen of air. Oh, that was awful.
Oh, the nights were worst of all, weren't they? Remember how I used to sit there by your bed and help you catch your breath? And we talk about our families and our mothers and our friends? You did suffer greatly. You did. Who are your four brothers, by the way? I knew Erastus and John. I didn't know Charles. I got to know Seth real well, too, because, as you know, he was in the hospital quite a long time, too.
Yes, he was, but he's real good now.
I'm so happy to hear that. I often think about all the young men whom I got to know in the hospitals, and most especially those I tended on the battlefields. I think and I dream, and I cry about all those things that happened from 1861 to 1865. And I try to figure out why these things didn't happen and what they meant to the soldiers who did the fighting. Also, I thought and thought about the people back home. Somehow the word mother is always prominent in every scene I envision. Mother, mother, in every language, in every part of the world, There is no other word that carries the same meaning as the word mother.
I know. All five of us brothers spent all those years. We were always worrying and praying about our mother.
Yes, you were all outstanding sons. She can be very proud of having raised such fine boys.
Well, we tried to be, but you have to remember that all five of us had a very fine mother.
Yes, I know, and that's what I so often think about. That word echoes and echoes in my mind. Do you know why?
Well, I just guess I haven't given it much thought, so I ain't in a position to give you much of an answer.
Well, as I served on the battlefields, I tended the wounded and the dying. And every man, every single one of them who was dying, always uttered the same word just before they drew their last breath.
They did? They all said the same word. What was that?
They all said the word mother. Some screamed it in awful pain. Some muttered it with their last breath. And some just quietly said, mother, 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 seeking that last bit of comfort before they died. That's why that word echoes in my mind. It's a sad word, and yet, in a way, the most beautiful word in the world. So I think so often about it, and about how mothers seem to have an invisible thread, a powerful, unbreakable lifeline to each one of their children, a lifeline so very powerful that nothing, absolutely nothing, can break it, except death.
Now that I think of it, you're right, Dr. Walker, you're right. All five of us felt that lifeline, and all four of us know very well that Seth was the one who was the very best at telling us and telling Mother how great that lifeline was.
Yes, as I got to know Seth better, I could see that was true. He was a most sensitive, articulate young man. And how fortunate you are to have such a wonderful brother.
We know. Seth's dedication to our mother runs right through every single one of his letters, just like a golden string tying them and us all together.
That's a very nice thing to say, and how absolutely true. You know what they always said? The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And it's just as true right this minute as it ever was, and for that, all of us can breathe a most grateful prayer of thanks.
Dr. Walker, you're so right.
On that note, I'll say goodbye and go on off to my home in Oswego, where I spent a wonderful childhood with an outstanding mother and also a most wonderful father who gave me such a pleasant childhood that, thankfully, I have a multitude of comforting, exciting, learned memories which I can summon when those from the battlefield sometimes tend to overwhelm me. Well, goodbye. Oh, I almost forgot. Since Mother's Day is such a special day and is almost here, we'd like to share our devotion and your devotion to our mothers with a little bit of a gift. So if you'll stay right where you are, we'll come around and give you a nice little gift.
You know, folks, the most remarkable thing about the letters is that at one time he was desperate enough to have his mother inquire of a congressman to buy his way out of the military. And that seemed to be quite prevalent during the Civil War, when the draftees were able to purchase their way out of military duty. A lot of this activity borders on what we have been going through during our military times recently, with the wars that we've had. I get a big kick out of the money factor when he said $35. That's a lot of money. in Civil War times, and he was sending it through the mail, which is very remarkable. But a lot of the wording is a lot different than what you would say for proper English and like this. It's very difficult to follow. But in any event, I found the letters to be very interesting, and this is what they look like, real small. Anybody have any questions? Go ahead, Mary.
When did he die?
I can't hear.
Pardon me?
Field of question. I can't hear too good.
When did he pass away?
What'd she say?
When did he pass away?
He died at the age of 92 in 1938. And his wife lived to be 88. No, he lived to be 88, and his wife lived to be 92. And in Greenfield, there's a Catherine Hill who lives in the same house where they grew up. And I asked her what they did to enable them to enjoy such a long life, and she said she wasn't sure, but she knew it was quite unusual for people to live that long back in the Civil War days. Maybe they were very happy with their five sons.
What did he do when he came back to Greenfield?
Why don't you come up here closer so we can hear your questions and the audience. Speak so the audience can hear also what your questions are.
What did he do for work when he came back?
They were farmers.
They were farmers?
Yes. 100% of the people in Greenfield were farmers, originally.
And Barry, where was he buried at?
He's buried in Wilton Cemetery, Cemetery in Wilton Road, the Greenfield Cemetery in Wilton Road. He and his wife are both buried there. So you can see his tombstone and his wife's tombstone. Her name was Olive Hewitt, and Hewitt was a very prominent family name in Greenfield in the early days also.
You mentioned that he was in the hospital.
Yes, he had chronic bronchitis and was very, very ill for quite a long time.
Was that after he got out of the Army?
No, that was during the war.
During the war?
Yes. He contracted the disease, the bronchitis, not exactly a disease, they thought it was from the climate. He wasn't used to the southern climate, the humidity all contributed to his problems. Seth was also in the hospital, but interestingly, he didn't tell his mother what was wrong in any of the letters. He kept saying, well, I'll be out pretty soon, I feel better, so we don't know. I don't know from reading the letters what was wrong, but he didn't want to worry his mother.
So Seth is the one who had the chronic bronchitis?
George had the chronic bronchitis.
George. Okay.
But we don't know what was wrong with Seth because he didn't say.
Okay.
Mary, how did you come about the letters? How did you find them?
The letters were loaned to me by Catherine Hill, who lives in Greenfield, four houses above the general store, right on 9M. And her husband was the great-great-grandson of Seth Hill. And her husband, of course, has been dead many years. But she had those letters in a cotton bag. There are 67 of them, and I spent probably 20 to 30 hours in the last 2 weeks going over them. You have to use a magnifying glass because some of the ink has faded, and some of the writing he did on his knee when he was about to go into battle, and the handwriting varied considerably. So it was very, very difficult to decipher. Also, their handwriting was beautiful, but he tended to like to do ornate writing. So he would put curlicues on some of his letters, and that sort of helped a little bit to make it difficult to read with all the curlicues. If he had the time, the curlicues were there. And you notice he said that he didn't have time to answer Sadie's letters, but he always had time to answer his mother's letters. And of course you notice too that all the way through he'd say, write soon, I didn't get your letter. Write and tell me if you got the $35. That constant communication took place.
You know, folks, the History Channel had on a terrific program about the Civil War and the peace. The peace was made by the generals, not the politicians. It was Grant and Lee agreed about laying down their arms, taking their horses and going back home and becoming farmers all over again. On the other side, it was Sheridan and Johnson who agreed to the surrender terms. The people in Washington, the politicians, wanted to bring serious consequences to Jefferson Davis, the president. Jefferson Davis wanted everybody to resume, to assume guerrilla tactics and went to the mountains, of which there are a lot now, the Blue Ridge Mountains, things like that. If they went into the mountains and had guerrilla warfare, it had probably been another 50 years before the Civil War was over. But the generals insisted, Grant and Lee, Sheridan and Johnson, that these fellows would lay down their arms, sign an oath that they would never go against the country again, and go home and resume life all over again. The politicians in Washington had a fit. They wanted to string up Jefferson Davis. Jefferson Davis was on the run, and the federal troops had a hard time catching him. But Lee and Grant and Sheridan and Johnson settled the peace situation. Of course, the politicians approved of it and like that after a lot of wrangling. Then on top of that, when Booth shot Lincoln, then they really had an uproar, then they really wanted vengeance. But the generals tampered down everything and said, no, it's all over with, they're going home, we're going home, we're going to resume the country. It was such a compelling 1 hour on the History Channel, you'd say to yourself, why don't they show that at Irby High School? It just made you feel what the people went through to bring a union. It's fantastic, 1 hour documentary. But that right there, those are the people who settled the problem of the Civil War. Otherwise, we would have had a guerrilla war in the mountains of West Virginia or wherever you can think of down there. And Jefferson Davis, he wanted it that way. But the general, the four generals, two federal, two Confederate, they settled the whole problem amongst themselves. Of course, on the set on the Sheridan side of it, there was a lot of liquor passed back and forth. You know what I mean? Have a drink, and like that. Well, they finally settled everything. But the remarkable thing about that whole program was that it was the generals in the field that brought this country together and said, no vengeance. This is perhaps the only Civil War in history where nobody, you know, paid for going against the government. And that's the way it is, and that's what we got today. And those four guys, those four generals, are the people responsible for the union we have today, not anybody in Washington. It was really a tremendous story.
You notice between, or among the letters, occasionally there's a reference to that matter or getting home, getting out of the service. And some people interpret that he was cowardly and wanted to run and get home. But that wasn't the case. His mother had five sons in the war all at one time. And he was concerned that all five of them would be killed, and then his mother would be completely alone. Now the point is, sure, there were friends and neighbors. But friends and neighbors are wonderful, but they don't take the place of five sons, do they? So Seth apparently was the most sensitive about this. George, a few of the letters in the cotton bag were from George, and he seemed to be more happy-go-lucky and things didn't bother him so much. But Seth was very sensitive, and he's thinking, suppose we all get killed. Mother will be up there all by herself. And several times she wrote and said to him, what will I do if you don't get home in the winter? And one time he answered and said, well, I can't really tell you what you can do, but he said, I'll send you some money. He said, I'll send $30 so you can be comfortable. And I was thinking perhaps that was for firewood. But Seth was very, very sensitive to the idea that maybe they'd all be gone and then Mother would be completely alone without her sons. So it wasn't cowardness that prompted his constant concern. And in one letter you heard him talk about Abe and writing, sending some letters to Abe. Yes, what was your question?
Was he the youngest, the oldest of the sons? I mean,
I don't know the birth order, and there's no indication of birth order anywhere. No. Marianne, what would you go?
Yes. Will the letters be available to researchers, and if so, where will they be archived?
Well, I don't know. I'll have to talk to Catherine and see. Right now, what I'm doing, I'm reading everyone and putting a little paper on the outside. I don't put anything on the envelope or the letters, of course, and I'm attaching a little paper on the outside giving the date in which the letter was written, where it was written, and the major topic of the letter. Was it getting home to Mother in the winter problems? Was it getting out of the service and whatever it was? So, and I have about 25 more to go. so it'll take another couple of weeks, and then I'll talk to Catherine and we'll see what happens. I don't know. Whatever she wants to do, they're hers.
There's another question.
Yes?
Did all five of the sons survive the war?
Have you looked at you?
Did all five sons survive the war?
They did. They did. Yes.
You know, folks, the most remarkable part about the letters is that during the Civil War, there were draft riots, people were getting drafted. There were riots in New York City, people were paying to get out of the military and like that. But Seth, just like Mary said, he was a very compassionate fellow. And this sort of prevailed through all the men that fought in that war. There were 600,000 people lost their lives in that war. What he did when he came home, he says he wasn't mad at the people that dodged the draft, so to speak. He said they had their soft feather beds. He wasn't mad at them. He forgave them. And that right there shows you the compassion that was the prevailing in those times among the fighting men. And I that right there stuck out in the letters to me when he said that he went home and he wasn't mad at those that he called it hunkered down. Those that, you know, stood at home and didn't have to go in the military.
Well, they didn't have to go because they could pay $300 and not go. They could pay for someone else to serve in their place. And many men did. Instead of going to Canada, like some of our people later on, they simply paid. And I've got a booklet in my office where it indicates every man who joined in the Civil War, where they joined, there were stations, and he signed up in Fonda, and what date they joined, and whether or not the town paid a bounty for them. It also indicates if they were wounded, where they were wounded, in what battle, if they died, and some of them died, well, more of them died of disease and infection than died of bullet wounds. So all of that is in this journal related to the Civil War. And you probably noticed in one of the letters, he refers to the young ladies up in Greenfield. I thought that was interesting.
Any other questions, folks? Hope I didn't talk too fast for you. Well, it's very interesting, the Civil War, and you just hope that they teach it in school nowadays and they really get into it because it's a beautiful story of how they preserved and made the Union. And it was all up to the generals and not the people in Washington. You can imagine after Lincoln was assassinated how vengeful the politicians in Washington were. They wanted Jefferson Davis strung up. Couldn't catch him at that time because he was on the run. But the thing is, cooler heads prevailed. And where were the cooler heads but amongst the warriors? That's different. The people that were, their job was to kill and destroy, they were the people that said, enough is enough. We're going to call, it's all over with, everybody goes home. I got a big kick out of listening to that TV documentary where they had him sign an oath that they would never resurrect again against the federal government.
By the way,
hope that was good enough. But the thing is, it was quite a story, that TV documentary, and I wish we had it here to show it. It'd be worth an evening viewing. But again, like I say, this is really unusual that the military men prevailed and made the peace, not the politicians, because they were full of vengeance and they wanted their due. And that right there is how we got this country, this beautiful country that we got. A lot of people suffered.
By the way, perhaps I could mention a couple sentences about Dr. Mary Walker. She was a surgeon, had two medical degrees, served on the battlefield and in the hospitals during the Civil War, and received the Congressional Medal of Honor, which she wore proudly, and I have a replica here. And she had two major ideas in mind. She wanted women to have equality. She worked all of her life to get the vote for women, unsuccessfully, of course. By the time she died, it hadn't happened. She also believed that women could not be effective in the way they were dressed during the Civil War. Now, the outfit I wore at the beginning, I had four petticoats. We saw the big bulging thing there. She said, they're all gussied up with corsets. How can they be effective? So what I'm wearing now is she jokingly remarked about it, that she was the role model for the new woman, the more effective, more productive woman, and she went to this outfit, which she always wore with her Congressional Medal of Honor. She also had another idea about medicine. You know, in the Civil War, that if a man got a wound in his ankle, for example, they just cut off his leg. And if he got a wound in his arm or his hand, they cut off his arm. And she said, let's not do that. Let's tend to the wound and not remove the arm or the leg. But they said, she's just a woman and she doesn't know. So they paid no attention to anything she said, which was very frustrating because she was a very bright woman and had studied medicine. Of course, sanitation wasn't in the vocabulary at that time, which is why so many of them died from infections. But she worked to try to change this idea of just cutting off arms and legs. And you know that many times by cutting off an arm or a leg, you caused an infection instead of preventing it. But they didn't pay any attention to her.
Any other questions, folks? Oh, and thank you all for coming.
Yes, thank you very much. Enjoyed having you.